Chris, are you recording for yourself or? Okay. Let me just open up the. Okay. So.
Hello, Kitty. Hey, Chris. Hello, Kitty, huh?
Is Chris unmuted? But unmuted, Chris. Chris, can you speak?
Yes, sir. Do I have sound now, guys?
Yeah, you have sound. That's good. Akhil, you have sound as well.
Yes.
Okay. Does anyone else need permission to record? Please let me know. Final call. Anybody else needs permission to record? Whether it's Radical, Moderate, or Sam, or Vladimir. Okay, so no one? All right. So I'll make Chris the spotlight in the video, right? Okay. Assalamu alaikum. Good night, everyone. My name is Brother Ijaz Ahmed of the Muslim Apologetics Podcast. And tonight we have a debate between Mr. Chris Claude and Mr. Akhil Ong-Q. I hope I got that surname correct. The debate topic is, does the Bible teach that Jesus is God? It's scheduled for 6 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, which is now. And this is the format as follows. 15-minute opening statements each, 7-minute rebuttals each, 5-minute rebuttals each, 15 minutes cross-examination each, and 5-minute closing each. Can the debaters confirm that schedule?
Yes.
Yes, okay. And the topic is correct as well, yeah? Okay, yes. So when you have 1 minute left on your allotted time, you'll hear the sound. And when you have finished your time, you'll hear it a second time. Okay, you are allowed to go over by 15 seconds, but that's it, okay? I will mute the person or let them know their time is up. So tonight, I believe Mr. Chris Claude will be going first. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay, so I'm going to mute my mic. I'm going to mute Akhil's mic, and I will begin the timer in 10 seconds. So you can. I'll give you a couple. Actually, you tell me when to start recording, okay? You might want to give a couple words or something. So let me mute myself really quickly. Stop video from me.
You can go ahead and start the time, Ijaz. I want to start off with a prayer here. And God, give me the strength to deliver your message with accuracy and clarity. I also pray that anyone who has this question we're talking about today, let them receive that answer today. And I also pray that you be glorified, God, that in at least one comes to Christ through the conversation that we have today. And in the name of Jesus, I ask, amen. So I want to start off by thanking Akhil for agreeing to have this debate with me, as well as Ijaz for hosting and moderating the debate. And last off, but not least, I want to thank everyone who is listening and for taking the time to listen to this important conversation. I want everyone out there to know that the topic at hand is, does the New Testament teach that Jesus is God? Not if the New Testament is authentic. So Akhil cannot question the authenticity of the New Testament given the topic today. Now, we as Christians believe in the triune God of Scriptures. We believe the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit are one God. Now, we are not debating the Trinity, but the Father is identified as God and as a person, and the Holy Spirit is identified as God and as a person. But we are speaking about Jesus today. I would also like to mention that we should be defining our terms the best that we can to avoid talking past each other as well. So I'll start off by saying, later on, I'll be talking about person and being in the discussion. Now, I want to make sure that when I say being, I'm referring to what someone or something is. And when I say person, I'm referring to who that person is. Now, there's one way that we can look at Scripture, and I'm going to run down these in point form and also give some references for what I'm saying. So Matthew chapter 1 and Luke chapter 2, verses 10 to 12, Jesus was born of a woman. The New Testament also says that Jesus was begotten, as well that Jesus was sent by God. We can find this in John chapter 3, verse 16. Oh, wait, there's more. Jesus did walk, he did eat, and he also drank and he slept. We can see examples of this through the New Testament as well. And I submit to the audience today that these are clearly not the attributes of God, but of man. In Mark 13:32, Jesus did not know the hour. In John chapter 10, verse 29, he says that the Father is greater than all. In John chapter 5, verse 19 and verse 30, Jesus states that he can do nothing by himself. And I submit to everyone in the audience today that these are the attributes of man and not God. Jesus also prayed to God. This is in Matthew chapter 6, verse 9 to 13, Matthew 11, 25 to 26, and Matthew chapter 14, verse 23, and Luke chapter 6, verse 12. And in Mark chapter 10, verse 18, Jesus says, only God is good. In John chapter 7, verse 3, Jesus declares the Father is the only true God. We as Christians believe Jesus died for our sins, and the Bible would say that God cannot die. In the New Testament, there is not one specific verse where it specifically states Jesus saying, I and God worship me. Now again, this is one view in regarding who Jesus really is. In this view, what people do is they specifically go after the humanity of Jesus and say, see, he can't be God. Now, I would say anyone who has this view regarding who Jesus is being very inconsistent and would reject the very nature of their argument being placed upon the Quran. As in to say, if we see in the Quran where there are violent verses, as well where there are peaceful and kind verses, would it be fair to go after specifically the violent verses and say, see, Islam is a religion of violence? Of course, Akhil would say, now, Chris, you must use these verses in context and with the whole of the Quran. You cannot isolate verses here and there and come up with your own conclusions. But this is exactly what Muslims do, this is exactly the tactic Muslims use against denying the deity of Christ. Also, another well-known apologist, Yusuf Ishmael, stated on a lecture that he gave that if one cherry picks, they're engaging in a failed argumentation. So I doubt Akhil will want to engage in a failed argumentation today. Now, these are the objections Muslims normally give to Christians, and we will see if they are cherry-picking or isolating certain verses and not allowing the whole Bible to speak for itself. Now, Akhil has accepted this topic, which is, does the New Testament teach that Jesus is God? So when I provide verses that show Jesus' divinity, he can't just assume they are corrupted. Akhil actually has to answer for them today. The New Testament says that Jesus was born of woman. But in that very same New Testament, this is the same Jesus that said, Father, glorify me with the glory I had with you before the world was. The New Testament says that Jesus did not know the hour. And in that very same New Testament, the apostles say to Jesus, you know all things. The New Testament says that Jesus worshiped God. And in the very same New Testament, Jesus is worshipped by all of creation. The New Testament says that Jesus ate and slept. And in that very same New Testament, the same Jesus says, he will give you food, you will never hunger again. The New Testament says that Jesus is a prophet. And in that very same New Testament, it also says that Jesus sends the prophets. The New Testament also says that Jesus got tired. And in the very same New Testament, the very same Jesus says, he can give your soul rest. The New Testament says that Jesus died. And in the very same New Testament, this same Jesus will come back to judge our souls and grant us eternal life or damnation. So if we allow the whole Bible to speak in Philippians chapter 2, it says, starting with verse 5, have this attitude in yourselves, which was also in Christ Jesus, who, although he existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of a bondservant and being made in the likeness of a man, being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even the death on a cross. So here in the explanation we receive in which is called the Carmen Christi, it shows that Christ Jesus, who existed in the form of God, emptied himself, took the form of a bondservant. So if God was to take on human form, he would have to enter this creation, and we would expect this bondservant would exhibit that of what humans would. Now the problem that Akhil will have to deal with is in John chapter 21, verse 17. This is where Peter says to Jesus, you know all things. And then he says, and you know that I love you. And Jesus says after that, feed my sheep. Now we see here that Peter said to Jesus, you know all things. And instead of Jesus saying, now Peter, I am only a prophet of God and God knows all things, Jesus said, feed my sheep. Now this is a very prolific statement as well. Jesus is declaring we are his sheep. So Akil will have to answer how humans can be the sheep of Jesus if Jesus is not God. Now what I want to go over is a reference we're going to hear about Jesus died. And if he died, how could he be God? Well, first off, I would ask Akil his definition of death. Because the definition I am appealing to in saying Jesus died is that he died a physical death, which is a prophecy as well. Now, I would reference Isaiah 53. And in saying that, Isaiah 53 talks about the death of the righteous for sin. Now, what does that mean? Death of the righteous. Now, we can start with Ecclesiastes chapter 7, verse 20, which says, indeed, there is no one on earth who is righteous. No one does what is right and never sins. So what I mean by righteous is one that is that never sins. Now, Paul reiterated the statement in Romans chapter 3, verse 10. As it is written, there is no one righteous, not even one. So we can determine that no mere human would ever be righteous in the sight of God. We've all fell short and we have all sinned except Christ. And this as well is foretold in Jeremiah 23 verse 5, which says, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will rise up for David a righteous branch, a king who will reign wisely and do what is just and right in the land. Also reiterated in Jeremiah chapter 33 verse 15. In those days and at that time, I will make a righteous branch sprout from David's line. He will do what is just and right in the land. So we can see here the death of the righteous in Isaiah 53 would die for sins, but we also see that no one is righteous before God. Yet Yahweh says he will rise up a righteous branch, which is identifying the Messiah. And no Muslim would deny that Jesus is the Messiah. So we see here that Jesus would rise up from the line of David, and if no human could be righteous and only God is righteous, we can deduct that God raised up his son from David's line to be the righteous offering for sin. Now, while we are talking, there will be references brought up about Numbers, where it says, God is not human that he should lie, not a human being that he should change his mind. Does he speak and not act? Does he promise and not fulfill? So when we look at the verse and what it actually says, it actually qualifies what it means by man, and that God would not lie, and he will also not change his mind as we do. Now this verse is not denying that God can take on human form. It is just denying the fact that God would lie or change his mind. So appealing to this verse today would be a red herring for my opponent. Another problem Akil will have to answer for this is in John chapter 4, verse 6. Jesus answered them and said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. So according to the New Testament, Jesus himself said no prophet can save us, and no prophet is the way, the truth, and the life. And without him, you cannot enter heaven, which means Moses can't save you, Abraham can't, David can't, and that's right, even Muhammad can't. Only Christ has this ability. Now, since Akil believes the New Testament does not teach that Jesus is God, he will have to account for how Jesus is the only way, the truth, and the life, and that no one comes to the Father but through him. Now, Akil may say all prophets are the way to God, but he will have to demonstrate another prophet saying these exact words about themselves. Now, I just want to give a few more verses where it does show the divinity of Christ as well in the New Testament. So this is in Titus chapter 2, verses 10 to 13. It says, not pilfering, but showing all good faith so that they will adorn the doctrine of God our Savior in every respect. For the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation to all men, instructing us to deny ungodliness and worldly desires, and to live sensibly, righteously, and godly in the present age, looking for the blessed hope and the appearing of Savior, Christ Jesus. Now, Akhil will have to answer how the New Testament can identify Jesus as our God and Savior if the New Testament does not teach that Jesus is God. Now, again, in John chapter 8, verse 12, it says, again, Jesus spoke to them saying, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. In contrast with Revelation chapter 21, verses 22 to 24, it says, and I saw no temple in the city, for its temple is the Lord God, the Almighty, and the Lamb. And the city has no need for sun or moon to shine on it, for the glory of God gives it light, and its lamp is the Lamb. By its light will the nations walk, and the kings of the earth will bring their glory into it. So in John 8, it says that Jesus is the light. And in Revelation 21, it says the glory of God gives the light. So we can deduct from this that Jesus is the glory of God that gives the light. Now also we can go to 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 8, and it says, none of the rulers of this age understood this, for if they had, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. In James chapter 2, verse 1, it says, my brothers, show no partiality as you hold the faith in our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory. But when we look into Psalms, Yahweh is the Lord of glory. Now I want to make another comparison in John chapter 5, 25, 28, and 29. It says, truly, truly, I say to you, an hour is coming, and now is, when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of Man. And I just want to contrast this quickly with the Quran. In the Quran, it says, and that they know that the hour is coming, no doubt about it, and that Allah will resurrect those in the graves. And the people is he who disputes to Allah without knowledge or guidance of an enlightening book. So we see that Jesus is the one that people will hear his voice in the final hour. But in the Quran, it says it's a law. I would like to see how Akhil can rectify that. So now to conclude my opening statement, I would say that the New Testament teaches many things. It teaches we are sinners. It teaches God took on human form, died for our sins, and rised on the third day, which is the gospel, the good news. Thank you very much.
Okay, so that was just on time. Brother Akhil, are you ready? Let me unmute your mic. Okay, thank you, Chris. Let me unmute your mic. Hold on. Chris. Okay, so Chris has been muted. Akhil, can you speak? I don't hear you. Hold on. Mute audio. Unmute. One more test, Akhil. Does anyone hear Akhil? Please indicate in the chat. I don't hear him.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, now I can hear you.
Okay.
Yeah, now we can hear you. Okay, so I'm going to start your time. Let me know when to start your time, okay, Akhil?
You can go now.
Okay, it started.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا حبيبنا نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Welcome to everybody. Peace and blessings upon all the guests. Thank you for attending. Thank you, Chris, for the invitation and also the opportunity to share the platform with you and Ijaz and all those responsible for hosting. Alhamdulillah, thank you for that and this privilege. So right to the point, inshallah, we want to get, don't want to waste too much time. And I want to make one correction. The topic, maybe it's just oversight, but Chris mentioned, does the New Testament teach that Jesus is God? The topic is actually, does the Bible teach Jesus is God? And he used the Old Testament, so it's clear that he understands, but just probably a mishap in his speaking. But just wanted to clarify that. So the question, does the Bible teach that Jesus is God? The Bible, which is literally a book of books divided into two sections, old and new, has been an article of controversy for a long time. And for many reasons, legal controversies, moral controversies, racial controversies, theological, etc. And I'm sure it will continue to be. The area concerned for us here tonight is a theological discussion. And I don't expect it to be an easy task to convince all to what we present. I don't think everyone will accept our presentation and agree with it. But nonetheless, we will do what we have. If we take the question of tonight's debate head on, then we will in fact need to examine the Bible to arrive at a conclusion, obviously. But alongside of examining the Bible itself, I would like to look into three essential states of God that are indispensable of his glorious nature. It is with these two observations, examining the Bible itself, as well as looking at these states of God, that I will make my case, which I think is a strong one indeed. To begin, I would like to ask the question another way. Does the Bible teach that God is Jesus? So if we take the question and we say this, the Bible teaches that Jesus is God, then let's ask that question another way and see what this does. Does the Bible teach that God is Jesus? And the reason I wanted to phrase it this way is because according to Christian doctrine, the Christians believe in what is called a triune God, where there are three persons and one being. And in this definition of this triune God, they believe the Father is God, the Son is God, and the Holy Spirit is God. But the Father is not the Son, and the Son is not the Father, and the Son is not the Holy Spirit, nor is the Holy Spirit God, and on like that. So they're distinct. And in Christian doctrine, from my understanding, and Christian, correct me if I'm wrong, but the Christians do not call Jesus the Father. Rather, they call him the Son. So in making this clear distinction that God is the Father, and we're going to see this also coming from the Bible itself, calling God the Father and identifying God as a Father as a separate entity, and then calling Jesus the Son or a man or something different, if we ask the question, does the Bible teach that God is Jesus, I think, comfortable with saying that Chris would even deny this idea of teaching that the Bible call God Jesus. And the reason I like us to consider this question is because according to Christian theology, the answer would be no, from my understanding. But if the Bible doesn't teach that God is Jesus, then how could it teach that Jesus is God? For according to Christians, are they not one and the same? If the Bible, in fact, does not teach that God is Jesus, then we're trying to prove it the other way around, not invite polytheism. If we're going to single out God alone as being one and say he's the Father, then if you say, okay, that you can't say that the Father is, or God is Jesus, how can we then turn around and say Jesus is God? And would this not be inviting another God alongside of God? And I know that this is the Trinity and it's complex, but it's something for us to think about as we go along and listen to these verses that we're going to hear. As Chris made some hint to some verses, maybe as what we call damage control or disclaiming these verses because we know that they are problematic for them, but nonetheless, we look at them. So this forced us to examine a little further about God, to actually see if the Bible teaches that Jesus is indeed him. So when we examine in God, we suggest the following essential attributes of God. These are attributes that I think are indisputable across the board, whether Muslims, Jews, or Christians. And I think that once we accept these attributes of God, then we have to now measure anything or anyone up to these attributes and descriptions that's indispensable to God's nature. And if anything or anyone fails to maintain these divine qualities that belongs only to God, then we have to disqualify that individual or that thing from being God. And it should not be the other way around. We should not say because things in creation have divine attributes that makes them divine, but rather can the divine actually be non-divine? Can the divine in its attributes be less than divine in its attributes? And we will all say no. God cannot be other than God. So when something displays itself or displays characteristics that is indicative that these characteristics and his nature is posing a conflict of it meeting to the standards of being God, we have to examine it and disqualify it as being God. And this is the reality of the matter. So now let us have a look at what the Bible says about some qualities of God and see, in fact, is this or can this be something that can be taken from him? Not if it can be ascribed to an individual or something else, but rather can God do without these qualities? This is a question that I want us to keep in our mind. Is it possible for God at any point and at any time be able to do without these qualities and we still call him God? The first one, of course, we begin, and it's very known, but we have to begin with it because it is so emphatic and important in the lives of those who this revelation came to, and that is the Shema of the children of Israel. And in Deuteronomy 6:4, it says, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one." The Lord is one. So God is one and unique in this sense, and there's nothing like him. And this is shared similarly in Islamic tradition and in the Quran where it says, "Kul hu Allahu ahad," that Allah, he is one and unique and like nothing else. Also in Isaiah 43, chapter 10 to verses 10 to 11, it says, "You are my witnesses, declares the Lord, and my servant who I have chosen, so that you may know and believe me and understand that I am he. Before me, no God was formed, nor will there be after me. Even I am the Lord, and apart from me, there is no Savior." So God is stressing emphatically, clearly, and I want to get to something if we have time. I want to get to an acronym that I want to use for us to measure these verses that we hear. Are they consistent, and can they be used to bolster the idea that Jesus is God? Also, we find in Isaiah 45, verses 5 to 6, "I am the Lord. There is no other. Apart from me, there is no God." This is very clear terminology, very decisive. Apart from me, besides me, next to me, before me, after me, this is all God. And God is understood in the Old Testament to be Yahweh. So the task that Chris has tonight is to prove that the Bible teaches that Jesus is in fact Yahweh, which I don't think that Jesus himself ever understood the idea of him being Yahweh, and this is clear from his statements. But it goes on, it says, "Apart from me, there is no God. Apart from me, besides me, next to me, there is no God. I will strengthen you, for you have not acknowledged me, so that from the rising of the sun to the place of its setting, people may know there is none besides me." Very emphatic, very clear. When a person reads the Old Testament, they won't leave reading the Old Testament with any ambiguity or any unclearness that who God is. It's clear God is one and he's authoritative. But when we talk about Jesus being God or trying to make that argument, it seems that we have to take verses and stretch them and put them together as if we need to make a puzzle. But this is not the language of God in the Old Testament. God is very clear about who he is. Yet the Christians still, 2,000 years later plus, are not clear exactly who Jesus is. And so it says, again, "People may know there is none besides me. I am the Lord, and there is no other." I mean, in one verse, 3-4 times, God is emphasizing that he is the one God alone. Next point, God is omnipotent. God is all-powerful. Isaiah 44:24. "This is what the Lord says, your Redeemer who formed you in the womb," who formed you in the womb. Now, we have to stop. Chris mentioned Jesus was born. In fact, he was. And he resided in the womb of a woman. God is the one that forms in the wombs. Irrespective of him not having an earthly father, nonetheless, still, he resided in the womb. And God is the one that forms the individuals in the womb. "I am the Lord, the maker of all things, who stretches out the heavens, who spreads out the earth by myself." And when God mentions by himself, as the Muslims will understand, this doesn't mean that God doesn't use agents, but rather means ultimately, everything goes back to God. So in the Muslim theology, what we call Aqidah, Muslims, we take medication. We take Tylenol, we take painkillers, we take this, we take that. But for a Muslim to believe that any of these medications or any of these things that we take to cure ourselves, if they believe that it have any intrinsic power, then this is committing shirk, because you are ascribing power to something that truly has no power. We say la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah, that there's no might or power except with God alone. So even though God uses means, he uses people, he uses tools, he uses the sun to bring heat to the earth and to give nourishment, these are means, what's called asbab, that God uses to accomplish his agenda. But ultimately, God is the one that does it and is responsible for it. So even if you see Jesus doing things in the Bible that may give the appearance that, oh, this is done by God alone or something, Jesus repeatedly, over and over and over again, said, I do these things by the finger of God, by the power of God. He testified to the fact that I am just a means that God is using to accomplish whatever it is God wills to accomplish, whether it be salvation, whether it be bringing light to the earth, whether it be guiding the people, whether it be resurrecting people, whatever the case is. Nonetheless, Jesus, and I say this with all due respect because we love him to the utmost, but he's nothing but a means that God is using to bring about the end and the will of God Almighty, not the other way around. Point number three, God is omniscient. God is the all-knowing. In Psalms chapter 139, verses 1 and 6, you have searched me, Lord, and you know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you, Lord, know it completely. You hem me in behind and before, and you lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. So this is just a verse declaring that God is all-knowing, and God knows every single thing at every single time in every single manner. So these verses, we want you to keep them in mind as we go along, because there's a point I've been making. So we're highlighting these verses to make our point. And the last verse is, God is ever-living. Isaiah 40, verse 28. Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. No one can fathom. So God does not cease to exist. God does not die. Now, also, we want to look at three states of God, three qualities that we believe is indispensable for God to remain as God. The first one is infinity. God is infinite from the very beginning to the very end. So anything contrast to this will invalidate or disqualify that one as being God. Second state is, God is the absolute creator. God is the one that has no beginning and was not created, and created every single thing afterwards. And thirdly, God is the one who is worshiped, and God does not give worship. Now, there's a phrase in Arabic that by the opposite, things are known. So if we look at the opposite of these three states, then we can see from this that nothing or no one, not even Jesus, peace be upon him, can measure up to these qualities. Jesus was finite. We know that because you say he died, even if he was resurrected.
Okay. Brother Akil, your time is up for your opening statement. Okay, so that's 15 minutes. We're going to take a short break to let Chris compose himself and get all his notes down. So I'm going to, Brother Akil, I'm going to mute you now, okay?
Okay.
Thank you. Akil. Remove the spotlight. Okay, so Akil is muted. Chris, can you hear me?
Yes, sir, I can hear you.
Okay, so we'll begin in just a second. For everyone in the room, I'd like to give you a link, please. It's going to be in the chat. If you would like to have a map host a debate or event, please submit your proposals in the link just pasted. And if you have any feedback about this event itself, about the speakers, the topic, please let us know. Here is another link to that form. So we have a feedback form and a debate proposal form. All right, Chris, you have 7 minutes. Let me know when you'd like to begin.
you can go ahead and start off the time now.
Okay, it started.
I want to start off by just pointing out a couple of verses from the Quran first. I'm going to start with Surah 3, verse 55. It says, "Behold, Allah said, O Jesus, I will take thee and rise thee to myself and clear thee of falsehoods, of those who blaspheme. I will make those who follow thee superior to those who reject faith to the day of resurrection. Then shall ye return unto me, and I will judge between you the matters wherein ye dispute." I'll also quote Surah 61, verse 14, that says, "O ye who believe, be ye helpers of Allah, as said Jesus, the son of Mary, to the disciples, who will be my helpers to do the work of Allah. Said the disciples, we are Allah's helpers. Then a portion of the children of Israel believed and a portion disbelieved, but we gave power to those who believed against their enemies, and they became the ones that prevailed." So I would really love to find out from Akil who these followers of Jesus were that prevailed to the day of resurrection, since we only have the New Testament documents up to, except for Gnostic Gospels, which I'm sure that you're going to reject as well. Now, another thing that was said is that in the Bible or in the Old Testament, it says this and it says that. But I'm going to go through and I'm going to compare verses with the Old Testament and the New Testament, and let's just see if that's exactly the way it is that Akil is trying to present to us. So the first thing I would say is, whose name should we call on? Now, if we look at Genesis 21, it says, "Abraham planted a tamarisk tree in Beersheba and called there on the name of Yahweh, the everlasting God." Psalms 31:5 says, "Into your hand I commit my spirit. You have redeemed me, O Yahweh, faithful God." Joel 2:32, it says, "And it shall come to pass that everyone who calls on the name of Yahweh shall be saved from Mount Zion in Jerusalem, and there shall be who escape, as Yahweh has said, among the survivors shall be those whom Yahweh calls." Acts chapter 7, verse 59, it says, "And as they were stoning Stephen, he called out, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. And falling to his knees, he cried out with a loud voice, Lord, do not hold this sin against them. And when they had said this, he fell asleep." Now I'm going to go to Romans chapter 10, verses 9 to 13. "Because if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, and you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes and is justified, and with the mouth one confesses and is saved. For the scripture says, everyone who believes in him will not be put to shame. For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. The same Lord is Lord of all, bestowing his riches on all who can call upon him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord would be saved." So anyone that calls on the name of Lord Jesus will be saved. Now we're going to see that who is becoming our salvation. Exodus chapter 15, verse 2, it says, "Yahweh is my strength, my song, and he has become my salvation." Psalms chapter 3, verse 8, "Salvation belongs to Yahweh. Your blessing be upon your people." Psalm 62, 1, "For God alone my soul waits in silence. From him comes my salvation." Hebrews chapter 2, verse 10 in the New Testament, "For it was fitting that he, from whom and by whom all things exist, and bringing many sons to glory, should make the founder of their salvation perfect through suffering." Jesus is the founder of our salvation. Hebrews chapter 5, verse 9, "And being made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation to all who obey him." Revelation chapter 7, "And crying out with a loud voice, salvation belongs to our God and who sits on the throne and to the Lamb." Now I want to see who sanctifies us as well. "You are to speak to the people of Israel and say, above all you shall keep my Sabbaths, and in the sign between me and you throughout your generations, that you may know that I, Yahweh, sanctify you." Ezekiel 37:28, "And the nations will know that I am Yahweh who sanctifies Israel and my sanctuary in the midst forevermore." Now, I just want to go over a few more things. In my opening statement, I actually acknowledged these things that Akhil was talking about. But the one thing that I'm hoping that he does actually acknowledge is the verses that show Jesus' divinity. In Philippians chapter 2, it gives us the description of the incarnation. But I'm just going to go over this argument one more time in my rebuttal as well. In the New Testament, it says that Jesus was born of woman. But in that very same New Testament, Jesus said, "Father, glorify me with the glory I had with you before the world was." The New Testament says Jesus did not know the hour, but in the very same New Testament, the apostles say to Jesus, "You know all things." The New Testament says that Jesus worshiped God. And in the very same New Testament, Jesus is worshiped by all of creation. The New Testament says that Jesus ate, slept, and in the very same New Testament, that very same Jesus says he will give you food. You will never hunger again. In the New Testament, it says that Jesus got tired. And in that very same New Testament, that very same Jesus can give your soul rest. In the New Testament, Jesus died. And in the very same New Testament, the same Jesus will come back to judge our souls and grant us eternal life and or damnation. So this conversation isn't about, well, I don't believe Jesus has the attributes that I want him to have. Jesus has the attributes of God. He's omniscient, omnipotent. He is the seer of hearts, which we can see in 1 Kings that only Yahweh is the one that can see into one's heart. So what Akhil actually has to do is he actually has to rectify how the New Testament can describe Jesus as Yahweh.
Okay, Chris, you have 15 seconds left if you have anything to add.
No, I can finish when my time's up.
Okay, no problem. So that was 7 minutes. Akhil, let me know when you're ready, please. Let me just mute Chris. Give me 1 second. Okay, Akhil, can you speak?
Yes, can you hear me?
Okay, yeah, I can hear you. Let me know when to start.
Okay, you can start.
Okay.
Bismillah. Okay, so I want to get to some of the points that Chris mentioned in his opening, as well as this first rebuttal. But let's just do a basic recap as well on the three states. And again, I want to emphasize that we're not looking at whether or not a human being or anything in creation actually demonstrated qualities of the divine. But what we are basing our premise off is that, is it possible for the divine to lose the qualities of the divine? Can God not be God? This is basically what I'm asking you. Can God be ignorant? Can God be weak? Can God be oppressed? Can God be hindered? Can God die? So these are qualities. We're talking about God, so we understand, because we're saying that the Bible teaches that Jesus is God. It's important for us to understand who God is. And I don't think that any Christian will want to believe that God can be deaf, or that God can be ignorant, or that God can be blind, or that God can be like this. And it's not a matter also, as the Muslims are accused of limiting God. We're not limiting God by saying these things that God can't do, but rather we are exalting God by saying that God is too great to be ignorant. God is too great to be dependent. God is too great to be subservient. God is too great to die. So if any of these qualities are attributed to God, then in fact you have lost God. And what you call that thing, you can call it whatever, but it's not God, because God made it clear of who he is and what he is. And as soon as you remove that from God, you're talking about something different. So God is infinite. We understand Jesus was finite. God is an absolute creator. We understand that Jesus had a beginning, which means he was created. God is the one who is worshiped. We know Jesus gave worship. God does not give worship to something. He is the one that everything gives worship to him. So when we look at these qualities, we have to, we are forced to disqualify anyone that comes short of these qualities. And again, not unfortunately, but in reality, Jesus, peace be upon him, falls short of having these qualities. Now, Chris, he mentioned some verses in the Bible that indicated, as he believed, the divinity of Jesus. And I mentioned verses in the Bible that I believe is clearly indicative of divinity only belonging to God. But when we have conflict, then won't we go to Jesus himself and find out exactly what Jesus said when these situations came to him? So for instance, there's a story in the Bible, it's called The Rich Young Ruler. He came to Jesus and he said, "Oh, thou good master, what shall I do to have eternal life?" Here's a perfect opportunity for Jesus to lay down the gauntlet, to tell him everything, who he is, what he's about, everything. The first thing he did was correct him. And he said, "Why do you call me good? There is only one that is good, and that is God." The devil took Jesus up to the mountain, and he tempted him, and he offered him all the world and everything. What did he tell him? He said, "It is already written that thou shalt worship thy Lord, thy God, who is one." Jesus said, "I can of my own self do nothing." He's showing us, he's telling us in very clear language, that don't ascribe the wrong thing to me. Chris mentioned about Jesus receiving worship. There's people in the Bible who receive worship, and David, and Chronicles, 1 Chronicles 29:20. David was worshiped along with the Lord. So now we're going to call David God as well. In Revelations, in chapter 3, verse 9, Jesus said that he would call the people, and they would worship at the feet of the disciples. So are the disciples also now God? So when we lead, when we use these arguments that's unclear and say, okay, well, this is referring to Jesus, or this like this, or look how the language is similar, we're not looking for similar language. We're looking for clear language. God is very clear in the Old Testament who he is. The New Testament is not as clear. Definition of death, he asked me about. So the definition of death is in this world that our soul is removed from our body and it hovers outside, that our body becomes spiritless. But are we going to attribute death to God in any kind of shape or fashion? Can we actually say God died in any kind of way? We're talking about God, not Jesus. I don't want to know if Jesus died. We're talking about, does the Bible teach Jesus is God? Are we willing to say that God, Almighty Creator, can die, or that he died? Is this something? Did the Father die? This is a question I want to ask Chris. Did the Father die, or can the Father die? Yes or no? God is not a man. And it's more than one place in the Bible where it mentions that, and God stated quite clearly that he's not a man. So if God is saying he's not a man, how can we then make him a man? These are verses that we can say, you know, we heard these verses before, and they're old, but they're not being dealt with. These are challenging verses about who God is, and when we look at Jesus, he doesn't fit the script. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. In fact, Jesus was the way, the truth, and the life at his time. And Chris said, "I had to bring proof to show this otherwise." We believe this is the message of all the prophets. All the prophets were the way, the truth, and the life. God sent Moses to who? The children of Israel, to do what? To guide them back to God and to get them out of bondage. All the way from that time up to Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. The Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, he said that any Jew or Christian who hear about me and don't accept me will be deprived of paradise. So he's also the way, the truth, and the life, and no one can get to God except through whatever door that God opened for them at the time of that respective prophet. So this is, you know, what we have. Now, there's an acronym that I wanted to use, if you have time to harp on this. It's an acronym called SCAN, S-C-A-N. And what this is that there are verses that we want that is said by Jesus himself. So that's the S, said by Jesus. Then the C is that the verse is clear and unambiguous verse. A is that...
15 seconds, man.
Okay, so A is that there has to be, like, I don't have the time in the 10 seconds to finish it. So I'll try to cover it on the next point, but I hope that this is sufficient.
Okay, and that's good. Let me mute Kiel. All right, guys. So we'll take a 1 minute break. Chris, we're taking a 1 minute break. Okay, guys. The next speaker will be Chris, and he will be doing his 5 minute second rebuttal. So we're just taking a 1 minute break. In the interim, I would like to remind the audience that we have two forms I just posted in the chat. The first form is a feedback form. Are you okay with the format? Are you okay with the topic? Are you okay with the speakers? You should be, because they're great. Alhamdulillah. Praise be to God. The second one is a debate proposal form. So if your name is Sam Shimon or Vladimir Susic, feel free to submit a debate proposal. We would be willing to host a debate on your behalf. Okay, Chris, just give me the thumbs up when you're ready, and I will. Okay, let's go. So Chris, you are unmuted, and the video is on you. 1 second. Okay, let me know when to begin. Timing you.
Okay, this is a 5 minute one too, right?
Correct, yeah.
Okay, I just want to get ready here myself. All right, go ahead and start. So Akhil has basically said that that God cannot die, and he's asking me if the Father died. This is probably the most ignorant question I've actually heard from a Muslim. How many times has a Christian said that the Son is not the Father, the Father is not the Son, and the Holy Spirit is not the Father nor the Son? So for him to ask me a question that, does the Father die, that just shows you his ignorance to what Christianity actually teaches. It teaches that there is three persons in one being, one nature and or essence, however you want to describe it. Now, I want to go over a few things that Akhil said, because I don't really... He says that in Revelations chapter 3, verse 9, that apparently he told people to worship his apostles. Well, in Revelations 3, 9, it actually says, I will make those who are the synagogue of Satan, who claim to be Jews, though they are not, but are liars. I will make them come and fall down at your feet and acknowledge that I've loved you. Doesn't say worship in that verse at all. Now, Akhil keeps saying that, oh, well, David was worshipped and all these other humans were worshipped. But what I would do is I would quote Revelations chapter 5. In Revelations chapter 5, I'll set up this scene for you. This is actually in heaven. In heaven. Jesus is receiving religious worship that only God would receive in heaven. Akhil has to answer for how Jesus is receiving this worship. Not just simply so to say, well, other humans received worship on earth. I'm going beyond that. I'm qualifying what I mean by worship, and that means worship in heaven. Now, my question would be to Akhil, who other than God would you worship in heaven? So I just want to go back over. I honestly think that Akhil is trying to do... to pull the red herring act and try to say, well, Jesus died, he can't be God. We've already went over Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 to 6. And then there actually states, let me do this again, have this attitude that is in yourselves, which is also Christ Jesus, who, although he existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God anything to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of a bondservant and being made in the likeness of man, being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even the death on a cross. So Akhil has not answered any of my rejections in the first rebuttal, and I actually thought that this was actually what was going to happen through this debate. We Christians acknowledge and we accept that God took on human form, died for our sins, and was raised on the third day. That's exactly what it teaches us in the Bible, and that is exactly what the debate is today. Now, another thing as well, I want to quote Revelations chapter 19, verse 10. Then I fell down at his feet to worship him, but he said to me, you must not do that. I'm a fellow servant of you and your brothers who hold to the testimony of Jesus. Worship God, for the testimony of Jesus is the Spirit of prophecy. So we see here in Revelations that the word proskuneo is used for worship. And we see here in Revelations 19:10 that John bows down to worship an angel. And this angel tells him, whoa, stop, don't be doing that. I'm a fellow servant with you. There is a reason why I wanted to appeal to this verse, and it is because Muslims seem to think we worship a man as God, which is far from truthful. We see in Revelations chapter 19, verse 10, that us Christians know we cannot even worship an angel because this is something that only God is worthy of. So to appeal to a Christian and say we worship a man as God is illogical, since we know we can't even worship an angel. Also, Akil hasn't answered for the reference that I brought up, that the Quran affirms that the followers of Jesus would remain victorious until the day of resurrection. Akil said that all prophets are the way, the truth, and the life. But show me one prophet that says that. I want one prophet that says, I am the way, I am the truth, I am the light. Jesus is identified as the glory of God. And my time is up. Thank you very much.
Okay, great. Well, thank you, Chris. Let me go ahead and mute you now. Spotlight video. Okay, Akil, can you speak for me?
Yes, can you hear me? Yes.
Yeah, I can hear you. Let me know when to stop.
Okay, good.
Okay.
Okay, Bismillah. All right, so first, Chris has accused me of red herring, and I don't know if this is a red herring, but accused me of red herring. I'm trying to cover, you know, some things you mentioned. There's many things that I mentioned you haven't even touched on. Time is short, and we have a lot that we're putting out there. But to accuse me of that, I think maybe is a strategy that you're red herring to take the attention off the fact you haven't dealt with my points. So I'm trying to. And you say that, you know, it shows my ignorance of asking, can a father die? No, it doesn't show my ignorance, but I did it so you can articulate clearly that you don't believe that God died. Yet you say God died. So it's double talk. You can't have it both ways. You can't tell me that the father can't die, but then God can die. This is an issue that we're going back and forth for years now, the Christians and the Muslims, and we continue. But this is a reality you have to deal with. This is your belief, not mine. You believe that the Father, the Son, and the Spirit are one, yet you dissect them into parts and say this one did this one and this one did that, and then but they're all one. If Jesus in the Bible says, I am my Father are one, then when Jesus died, that would mean God the Father died also, unless God and the Father is not one. So, you know, we may not like the argument, but that's the reality of the matter. Revelation 3:12 states that Jesus in the heavens have a God. He calls God my God. So if Jesus is in his glory as God with God the Father, then he should be referring to himself as God. Yet he still calls God my God. So what God in heaven is Jesus worshiping and referring to in heaven? Are there two gods in heaven? If you're saying what other God would I worship in heaven, I'm asking you, saying to you, I would worship the same one in heaven that Jesus is talking about. Because Jesus is saying, in heaven, my God. So we have to answer for that. Jesus is saying in Revelation 3:12, he has the God in heavens. What God is that one? Then he says, what prophet says, one prophet that says the exact words, I am the way, the truth, and the life. So here now we have our Christian brother asking us to give us an exact verbiage of this message of saying, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one can get to the Father except through me. We have this in the example. We have this in other aspects of their speech. But the question comes back to you is where, which is even more important, where in the Bible does Jesus ever say he's God? That would be something that we would more want verbatim than worry about a prophet saying, I am the truth, the way, and the life. Jesus has to tell us clearly, I am God. Worship me, and he hasn't said that, so how can we accept this from Christians about Jesus? If you're asking for exact words for the prophets, I'm asking for exact word from Jesus to tell us that he's God. If you want your exact words, I want my exact words as well as it relates to this. Now, some other points from the New Testament about the distinction, clear distinction between God and Jesus. In 1 Timothy, chapter 1, verse 2. we read about how it's made that God is the Father and Jesus. So here it's telling us that God is one individual and Jesus is another individual. We have also in 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 5, about God and Jesus being a mediator, which means that Jesus is under God. So you have God, the exalted one, the sublime, the one true God, and then you have someone under him that's serving as a mediator. So it's clear that Jesus is being made distinguished from God and that he's not being made God. And these are clear verses that showing us distinction between the two. We have to reconcile these verses that show clearly that Jesus and the Father are not the same. And this does not satisfy the idea of believing a Trinity that is not mentioned or articulated in the Bible whatsoever, in the Old Testament or the New Testament. And there's many verses, but my time is up.
You still have 30 seconds left.
Okay, so good. So then I mention another verse. We have in Corinthians, 1 Corinthians 15, 28. The Son is subservient under God. The Son is subservient under God. Chris, is God subservient to anyone? Is a part of God subservient to anyone? So this, I mean, answer this. Are we going to say God is subservient? Or this is his human side? No, it's not his human side. God is God, and Jesus is something other than God. Thus, the Bible don't teach that Jesus is God.
Okay, so that's Brother Akhil's time for the second rebuttal. Now, we do have to go on to the 15-minute crossfire section. I believe Chris will be going first, if I'm not mistaken. Okay, Chris will be going first. Just a minor note for those in the chat, please no insults towards religious figures, no mocking of individuals, please. I give out warnings already. Please be nice, guys, okay? So let me unmute Chris, put him on spotlight, and mute Akhil. Okay, so this will be taking 15 minutes long, I believe. Chris, let me know when you're ready.
Yeah, I'm ready now, Ijaz.
Okay, and you can start.
All right, so Akhil, in Philippians chapter 2, verses 10 and 11, it says that every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus is Lord. Are you willing today, Akhil, to bow your knee and to confess with your tongue that Jesus is Lord? Are you willing to do that today, Akhil?
Bismillah. Well, of course not. That I don't bow or give my worship or subservience to anyone except God alone in an absolute sense. But if bowing means accepting a prophet or a messenger as being who he is and following his way, then as we accept the prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, we accept Jesus, we accept Moses, we accept Aaron, we accept Abraham, Ismail, all of them, we accept that they were prophets and messengers from God, and we accept their way in that regards. But if you're saying that bow down to Jesus because Jesus is God, then I don't believe that this verse is saying Jesus is God, because we show the distinction that Jesus and God is different. So this is your interpretation,
all right, so
that Jesus is God, but I don't believe that this is the interpretation that demands for Jesus to take worship as the divine creator, as the Father.
So you're willing to today, because you believe that the New Testament does not teach that Jesus is God, so since it does not teach that Jesus is God, you have no problem bowing down and confessing with your tongue that Jesus is your Lord then, right?
No, I would not bow down to Jesus as my Lord. Rather, I only bow down to God as being my Lord. And I accept the fact that Jesus is a creation of God, that he sent to guide humanity and be an example and a sign for humanity. This is what I accept. But do I accept to bow down to Jesus as Lord and God? No, I do not. And I would never do so.
Why do you not accept to bow down and confess with your tongue that Jesus is Lord? What's problematic with that?
Because Jesus is a human being, and Jesus gave subservience and worship to God. So again, if I'm aspiring to God Almighty, then I'm going to follow in Jesus' footsteps and pray to the one that Jesus prayed to. I'm going to call upon the one that Jesus called on to. why am I going to stop short and call upon Jesus when Jesus called upon God?
So are you trying to say that if one was to bow their knee and to confess with their tongue that Jesus is Lord, this is something that is only attributed to God?
No, what I'm saying to you is that your interpretation, you're imposing that Jesus is Lord, meaning that Jesus is God. I'm saying I don't agree with your interpretation, and I will only bow down and give my subservience to God alone, just as Jesus did.
But
so I'm going to follow Jesus. I'm going to follow Jesus and worshiping God and calling upon God and bowing down to God, just as Jesus did.
Our debate today, though, is does the Bible teach that Jesus is God? Is that correct?
Yes.
Is Philippians chapter 2, verses 10 and 11 in the Bible?
Yes, it is.
In Philippians chapter 2, verses 10 and 11, when it says that you must bow your knee and confess your tongue that Jesus is your Lord, is this saying that Jesus is God?
No, it's not.
Then can you do it, sir, since it does not mean that he's God? Because you just said that you would only do this to God. But since you've just said that this does not mean that he's God, you should be able to bow down, confess with your tongue that Jesus is your Lord, unless that is shirk in your religion.
But mind you, Chris, I said that given your interpretation of it. You're missing and you're cherry picking. I said, because of your interpretation of that verse, you understand to mean that Jesus is Lord. I don't.
So then bow your knee and confess that he's your Lord. If that doesn't mean that he's God, then it's not shirk to you, right?
The interpretation that you give, and that we also believe that the people in the Bible also have of this idea of Jesus being Lord, which is distinguished from God, is an interpretation that Jesus has something more than humanship. I don't accept that.
Did you just say that Lord is different than God?
Yes, it is. Is it not in the Bible?
In the Quran?
Say that again.
The Lord is not Allah?
No. So, are we debating the Quran or the Bible, Chris? Chris, don't jump ships now. We're debating the Bible. And in the Bible, I just showed you from Timothy, from Corinthians, I just showed you where there's a distinction between God, the Father, and Jesus. He's called the Lord. But Lord and the Father is different. So don't tell me what the Quran says about Lord and Allah and Lord is the same. We're not discussing the Quran. We're discussing the Bible. Does the Bible teach that Jesus is God? And in the Bible, Lord and God is different. And you know that. So why would you even come with that argument? You know better to do something like that.
But it's not, sir, because you're actually providing evidence for my point. I'm quoting Philippians chapter 2, verses 10 and 11, which you've already stated is in the Bible, right?
Yes.
So in Philippians chapter 2, you've already stated does not show that Jesus is God. Is that correct?
The word Lord in that passage or in other passages in the Bible, does Lord refer to a man or does it refer to God exclusively?
In the Bible, we are monotheistic. If we're to bow,
I didn't ask you that. I'm asking you the word Lord that you are emphasizing.
God, and we can do that to Jesus because he is God.
No, I'm asking you, in the Bible, the word you're emphasizing, the word Lord, is that word used for human beings as well or God exclusively?
Are you going to use it in this verse and in context, or are you just going to go on a general view of, hey, wait, whoa. So this is a cross-examination? I'm questioning you. You're going to have 15 minutes after we're done to question me.
Okay.
You can save your questions for later. So in Philippians chapter 2, verses 10 and 11, you are stating you will not bow your knee and confess that Jesus is God?
No, I will not.
Why not? What's problematic with that?
The problem is the understanding that Christians have of this verse is inviting to something that is against my belief. So I don't need this verse to confirm my belief in God because I have a Quran, as you mentioned. And the Quran corrects the ideas, the misunderstandings that was put into the minds and understandings of Christians about the aspect of Jesus and his character and his nature. So this verse that you have there, your understanding is that it's talking about Jesus being Lord and you're calling people to confess that he's Lord. This is not my belief, my understanding. But at the same time,
I understand that it's not your belief and your understanding, but you're questioning our book.
That's fine.
And that's what the debate actually is today, right? So let's move on to my next question. In Titus chapter 2, verse 13, it says, waiting for our blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. Is this attributing God, Jesus Christ to being God?
I'm sorry, I had company come in. Read the verse again, Chris.
Titus chapter 2, verse 13, waiting for our blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. Now, what does this verse tell us, Akil?
While waiting for, let me get the verse and examine it. Titus chapter 2.
He identifies Jesus Christ as our great God and Savior. Yeah, sir. We only actually have 15 minutes.
Okay, so in this verse here, I can't tell you that this verse is not calling for the idea that God is that Jesus is God here. It gives indication that the verse is calling Jesus God, but is that God the same God? Because also in the Bible we find other people are called gods.
No, sir. This is where you go off on your red herring, sir.
No, I'm answering the question, Chris. Let me answer the question. It mentions God there, and it calls him God. But I'm saying also in the Bible, there are other places where people and things are called God. But it doesn't mean that they are the true Father God. So if he's given a title that people are exalting him to be beyond human, that doesn't mean that he is the Father absolute, the Yahweh.
Yeah, we do not believe that Jesus is the Father, though, Akil. We believe in the three distinct persons in one essence, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So you are presenting nothing but a red herring. We do not believe just the Father. And if any other spot, we can't assume to that. So again, in Titus chapter 2, verse 13, it actually says, great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, the Savior that is identified is the Savior for eternal salvation. All these human people that you mentioned cannot give us eternal salvation, but Jesus Christ can. So can you please answer the question?
So
is this chapter 2, verse 13, identifying Jesus as God?
I answered the question and I answered it again. When we examine the Bible, we see that the word God is used in different ways. Now, you keep saying that you don't believe that God is the Father. Okay, this is your belief. But what I try to establish in the beginning of my presentation is that when we examine the Bible, and because the Old Testament is a premise that you accept as being valid from God, and I can appeal to, I say that my belief of what God is in the Old Testament is Yahweh the Father. You're telling me that Jesus is not Yahweh.
So are you trying to tell me that in the New Testament that Jesus is actually described as God in some way?
I'm saying that Jesus is described as God, in according to this verse, the same way that the devil is called God in the Bible. Is the word that's used?
True, because the devil does not give us eternal salvation. In Titus chapter 2, verse 13, it says, our great God and Savior. No one says that Satan is our Savior. So no, it is not in the same sense. Please use the verse and don't just go off to your own understandings of it.
No, listen here, Chris. What I'm saying to you, clearly, is that you have a verse in the Bible that uses the word God as it refers to Jesus.
Our Savior.
Listen. But you're failing to acknowledge or accept the fact that the word God is used, this word God is used in other places for other things. And even though it's tied into giving eternal life or Savior or salvation, still, Jesus may have a higher quality, a higher essence than a normal person as understood in the Bible. But it doesn't raise him to the level of God the Father, Yahweh. And this is the question. When we say who's God, does the Bible teach Jesus is God? Okay, so we need to go back to who is God. God in the Old Testament is Yahweh. I'm asking you, is you telling me the Bible, New Testament, teach that Jesus is Yahweh? Yes or no?
The New Testament does teach that Jesus is Yahweh, and I've been able to show the examples through the debate to be able to substantiate my view. And it doesn't really matter if you agree with me or not. Honestly, this debate isn't if you accept it or not. It's what's actually being said. So again, I will restate in Titus chapter 2, verse 13, it qualifies what it means by God. And it says, and Savior for eternal salvation.
I don't have a problem with accepting.
There's only one that can give eternal salvation.
No.
The rest can't.
I don't have
Jesus
a problem.
Christ is God who gives us eternal salvation.
Okay. I don't have a problem with accepting that Jesus is a means by which God gave eternal salvation
to humanity.
A means. A means means something that God used to bring about something. Jesus
so,
is
so
a
you're
means.
Okay with, so you're okay with Jesus being the means and that everything was created?
I'm saying whatever God decided to use Jesus for, nonetheless, he's an agent and a means that God the Almighty used. You don't want to accept this fact. You don't want to accept that Jesus is a means. There's someone behind Jesus.
Do you accept Tawheed al-Asma' wa-Sifat?
I accept every aspect of Tawheed. Yes, I do.
Now, does Tawheed al-Asma' wa-Sifat attribute the most beautiful names and attributes only to Allah?
In this absolute sense. In its unrestricted sense.
But you just said that you're okay with God using Jesus as means of creation.
So, if Jesus is being used, Chris, you're forcing me to ask you a question because if God is using Jesus, that means Jesus is not absolute. He's a tool. He's being used by something or someone. You don't get it. Jesus is being used by God. God is the ultimate agent of salvation.
So I'm going to go over this again. In Philippians chapter 2, verses 10 and 11, you will not bow your knee and confess that Jesus is your Lord because you would only do that for Allah. Is that correct, sir?
That's correct.
So again, in Titus chapter 2, verse 13, would you identify Jesus as your great God and Savior, or would you say that he can't be only Allah is?
I accept that Jesus, this is the answer, that Jesus is a means that God used to bring about salvation to those people.
No, sir.
I accept
that. That's not the question. That's not
my question. No, that's not the answer you want.
My question is,
that's not the answer you're looking for.
Would you be able to say that Jesus is your great God and Savior, or would you say it's only Allah?
Jesus is a means that God used to bring about salvation.
So you're committing shirk right now, according to Tawheed al-Asma' wa-Sifat.
No. I'm not committing shirk at all because we find
things to creation that are only attributed to Allah. Thank you very much, Akhil. I think my time is done.
Okay, so that was 15 minutes and 10 seconds. You guys did really well. You kept your question and answers under 1 minute each, so there was never any reason to intervene. Akhil, let me know when you're ready to begin for your 15-minute cross-examination.
Okay. I'm ready.
Okay, give me one sec to set the clock. I'll set it to 15 minutes, 15 seconds. Chris, are you ready as well?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, so... I will be switching the spots because Chris will be answering. And Akhil, ready to go?
Yes.
Okay. Just one note. Again, in the chat, we are seeing insults and towards religious personalities. We are going to ask again, please stop this behavior. Okay, guys? And Akhil, you may begin.
Okay. And also, I want to say, and I think I speak on the behalf of Chris as well, because we discussed this prior too, but Ijaz mentioned it. And we're also going to reiterate it. If you don't want to have manners here, we ask you to leave. Or we ask you, Jazz, those people just to cut them off. Because this is not one of those debates where, you know, this is tolerated. Chris is reputable, and I believe that he believes I'm reputable. So that's why we can get together and have this kind of conversation, despite our differences or disagreements. But nonetheless, we're not going to tolerate the nonsense and the vile comments on the section. So, Ijaz, I think I speak for Chris as well. If they don't condone themselves better, then just cut them off, please. That way, we won't have to keep having insults and keep addressing this situation. Sorry for that.
Okay, Akhil, tell me when you're ready to start your time.
Okay, I'm ready.
Okay, Chris, are you ready as well?
Yes, sir.
Well, let's go. Time's running.
Okay, so Chris, I have to ask you this question. Do you believe that Jesus is an agent of God that God uses, or do you believe that Jesus is the ultimate God? Is he just an agent, or is he the ultimate God, according to what the Bible presents?
What do you mean by an ultimate God, though?
Is he an agent, meaning that God is using him? He's being used, or is he the one that's ultimately in control?
Well, I don't agree with your the way that you're wording it.
You don't have to agree. You don't have to agree. According to the Bible, does the Bible present Jesus as an agent of God?
The Bible presents Jesus as God.
Does it present him as an agent of God? Yes or no?
It presents him as a person. It presents him as God, one of the three persons in the one nature, essence, or being of God. It portrays him as God, actually.
Yeah, but you're missing. You're not answering the question. You know what agent mean? Someone that's being sent by someone or being used by someone or something else.
Sure.
So I'm asking you, is he used by God as an agent?
Yeah, God the Father can use God the Son as an agent.
And do you believe, according to the Bible, that Jesus is subservient?
In what manner, sir?
Is he subservient to someone above him?
In what manner, sir?
In any kind of manner.
Why? I need to know what manner that you're speaking to.
In general, is Jesus subservient to God? If God commands Jesus, must he respond?
So the way that I look at it is, yes, there is authority within the personhood of God, the Father, then the Son, then the Holy Spirit. The reason for this is that the Father is above the Son and whatnot, even within us. Now, we have to ask ourselves a question. If the Father is a Father, when did he become a Father? He would have only become a Father when the Son was born, type thing, right? Like, I become a Father when my first son was born. Before my first son was born, I was not a Father. But the problem is...
So what you're saying is that God...
since eternity. So therefore, the Son has been the Son since eternity.
So what you're saying is that God somehow is evolving. As he creates something, he becomes that thing. So before God created, was he the creator?
No, sir. That's not what I said. That's a false question. So.
Okay, so let me ask you a question. Before God created, was he the creator?
God is the creator, yes.
Okay, so you say he cannot be a father unless he have a son. So I'm saying just as he was the creator before he created, he also was a father before he had any children.
The reason why that God the Father was a father is because he did have a son. But the problem is that the Father has been the Father since eternity. You only become a father when you have a son. So therefore, the eternal Son, which means the eternal Father, would presuppose that there has to be an eternal Son.
According to human existence. But if you presuppose that, Chris, that means that also God did not become creator until he created something, according to your logic. Because you're saying that he only becomes a father when he has a son, which means...
Wouldn't that make sense?
Huh?
Wouldn't that make sense?
No, it wouldn't, because God has always been as he is. Nothing adds to God. So you have a dilemma that you're saying that God only became the creator when he had something to create. God became the forgiver when he had somebody to forgive. Oh, wait. God became merciful when he showed mercy. God became the answer of prayer only when someone asked a prayer to him. So you're saying God is developing qualities as existence go about.
No, sir, that's not what I said.
That's exactly what you said. You said you said God would not be a father unless he had a son. Which
that's
means that by having a son...
You can't be a father without having a son.
Can you be a creator without a creation? Can you be a creator without a creation?
Can you exhibit how that could be possible?
I'm asking you, can you be a creator without a creation? We're talking about God, who's infinite. Can God be the creator of all even before he created anything?
Yeah, sir. I would just have to ask, what does this have to do with the actual topic of does the New Testament or does the Bible teach that Jesus is God?
Because we're talking about understanding God now. So now let's not try to evade the point because your answer, Chris, I'm asking you, God, the Almighty Creator, Did he become creator once he created something, or was he always a creator before anything was ever in existence?
Give me an example, sir, so I can answer to it.
I'm giving you an example. God, the Almighty Creator, before he created anything, was he still the creator? Was he still named the creator?
Can you give me the reference from the Bible that you'd be quoting?
I'm asking you a simple question, Chris.
Is it from is it from the Bible?
In the Bible, says in the beginning.
Excellent.
Before the beginning of history, was God the creator?
Sir, you would actually have to give me the question from the Bible, because that's the actual topic.
Chris, you're running, and that's not fair. Let me ask you another question. Okay, I'll ask you another question. God is the hearer and forgiver of prayers, right? He's a hearer of prayers and forgiver.
Yes, sir.
In the beginning, when there was no one to pray to God and for God to forgive, was he still a forgiver and a hearer of prayers?
Can you give me the verse in reference so that I can address it?
I'm giving you a question. I'm asking you to answer it.
So you're making
we're talking about God. I'm asking you about God. You told me that God can only be a father because he needs a son. So according to your logic, what you have done is that you have said that God can only have qualities after the fact of the matter, which means that God is always changing. God wasn't the creator. I know it's complicated. I know it's very complicated, Chris. I know. I'm sorry for that, man. I'm sorry. But what you're saying is that God wasn't the creator until he created something. So if in the very beginning, you agree that God is the creator, that means that everything that was there from the beginning also was created, because he's called the creator. So that means anything other than him was created, which means Jesus was created and everything with him aside from him.
No, sir.
No?
No, Jesus is uncreated, because in John 17:5, Jesus actually said, "Father, glorify me with the glory I had with you before the world was." So before there was even creation, the Son was with the Father.
But was God called the creator?
You would have to show me a verse within the Bible before.
I don't have to show you anything. I'm asking you according to your understanding of God. Was God the creator after? Okay, next question. Jesus himself. Can Jesus send God or command God, or only God the Father can send and command Jesus?
Well, the question doesn't even make sense, because we believe that Jesus is God. So could God send God? That's just a nonsensical question. Could you rephrase it, sir?
I'm glad you admitted that, because this is what you believe. Jesus was sent by God. God sent Jesus.
God the Father sent God the Son. We don't believe God sent God, because that would be polytheism, and we don't believe that. We are monotheistic.
Okay, so is Jesus God?
Jesus is God the Son, yes. He is one of the three persons of the Godhead. He's one of the persons within the one nature.
So if God sent Jesus, who is also God, is that not God sending God?
It is God the Father sending God the Son.
Okay, so can God the Son send God the Father?
No.
Why?
Because, have we read the Bible?
I'm asking you, please, as a question, Chris.
The Son is sent to take on human form, to die for our sins, and be raised on the third day.
That's not the question. I'm asking you, can God the Son send God the Father?
But that's not the way it's described in the Bible, of course.
I didn't ask you that. I'm asking you a question. You can say yes or no. Can God the Son, we know God the Father can send God the Son, because it's mentioned all over the place. But I'm asking you, since they're co-equal and co-eternal, can he reverse it? Remember my opening statement. Chris.
That there's authority in personhood.
Remember in my opening statement, I mentioned, if we take this question and turn it around, does the Bible teach that God is Jesus? Remember that. I opened that with this. So I'm asking you, can God the Son send God the Father? Yes or no?
In the Trinity, there is authority within the Godhead.
You're not answering the question, Chris. You're not answering my question. I'm asking you, can God the Son send God the Father, just as God the Father sends God the Son?
Three times in the authority within the Godhead, Father sends the Son. Son doesn't send the Father.
So the Father is higher and greater than the Son. There's a distinction.
What do you mean higher and greater? They're both God.
Well, Jesus said the Father is greater than I.
Yes, as a human. In his humanity, he did. Amen to that, too.
Okay, so I showed you
in the very same Bible, Peter says to Christ, "You know all things." And Jesus said, did he say, whoa, I'm only a prophet, only God knows all things? No, he accepted it. He said, feed my sheep.
Jesus said that I don't know the hour, so he already negated that before. But the point being,
Jesus said, I don't know the hour in his humanity.
Okay, so let's deal with
the answer, sir.
Okay, so let's deal with it. I'm sorry.
Jesus did not know the hour in his humanity. In his divinity, he knew all things. But you haven't addressed that.
Okay, so let me ask you another question. I showed you in the Bible in Revelation 3:12 where Jesus in the heavens now, in the heavens.
Yes, calling, I've already stated there's an authority in the God.
It's calling on another God.
It's his Father.
Okay,
and there is
so,
an authority in the Godhead, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. We acknowledge that already, sir.
So, but you said in the earth, that Jesus is the Father is greater than Jesus as a human on earth. But I'm showing you in the heavens also, he's still calling on someone greater than him.
He's not saying that the Father is greater than me in heaven, sir. He only states that in his humanity, you're trying to misrepresent the actual verse.
So if someone has a God, is that God not greater than that individual? Is God not greater than whoever calls upon him?
Not if he's God himself as well. No.
So in the heavens, even God is calling upon God in the heavens.
God can talk to God. Yes.
Does God the Father call upon Jesus? Does God the Father call and pray to Jesus the Son?
When does God the Son pray to the Father in heaven, sir?
He calls him my God.
Okay, but where does he pray to him?
By the fact you call him my God means that God is one who's worshipped. This is the meaning of God. God is the one who's worshipped.
But in Revelation chapter 5, the Father and the Son are worshipped together by all creation.
Okay, so I showed you also in the Bible, so is David and God. That doesn't mean anything.
No, sir, this was in heaven in Revelation chapter 5. David was on earth. You show me another person in the Bible that is worshipped as God is in heaven, as I've shown in Revelation chapter 5, verses 13 and 14.
And what I'm asking you is when we look at Jesus, even in heaven, he's still calling on God, which the meaning of God itself is the one who's worshipped, the ultimate authority, God.
Yeah, Jesus, which is God the Son, can also call on God the Father in heaven. We have no problem with the authority of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
My question to you, though, is does God the Father call upon and worship Jesus the Son?
You show me where God the Son worships the Father in heaven. I just showed you in Revelation chapter 5, verse 13 and 14, where the Father and Son are worshipped by all of creation.
You showed me that, and I'm asking you again. I showed you in Revelation 3, Jesus is still calling God my God.
You show me where Jesus worships the Father in heaven.
Okay, let's move on to the next question, Chris, because I see that we're not getting away with this one.
I figured you would move on because there is no scripture in the Bible that states that the Son worships the Father in heaven, as you've missaid.
Okay, but there's no scripture in the Bible that says the hypostatic union. There's no scripture in the Bible that says that Jesus is 100% God, 100% man. There's no scripture in the Bible. Huh?
Is this your question, Akil?
No, I'm making a comment on what you said.
Okay, so no, this is cross-examination. You need to question me, sir.
Okay, so I'm leading to a question, but you made a point, so you can't tell me I can't answer your point. You're telling me it's not in the Bible, this. I'm showing you also there's so many beliefs you have. Well, since you want to ask, is there a verse in the Bible that says that Jesus is 100% man, 100% God? Is there a verse that says that?
Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 to 10.
Since you want a verse, is there a verse in the Bible that says that Jesus is 100% man, 100% God?
Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 to 11.
It doesn't say that. It doesn't say Jesus is 100% man, 100% God. It doesn't say that, Chris.
Sure it does. Let me read it here. I get to answer you. Have this attitude in yourselves, which is also Christ Jesus, who, although he existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant. So therefore, the start is saying that he is in the form of God. Halfway through, he takes the form of a servant. This is showing the humanity and the divinity of Jesus in one specific verse.
No, it doesn't. This is not the hypothetical unit showing that Jesus was 100% God, 100% man. Because according to Christian theology, let me ask you a question. According to Christian theology, you have, is that
15 seconds?
It's okay. I can't answer the question. You won't be able to answer. I don't want to ask the question and throw it out there and he can't answer. That won't be fair. So we can conclude.
Okay, that's the conclusion of the cross-examination. Now, I do need to remark on both debaters' attitude during the debate. You guys were asking each other questions when it was not your turn to ask questions. Both of you were guilty of this, but I guess you got caught up in the heat of the debate. So it's just a gentle reminder to stick within the rules, okay, guys? I didn't want to intervene.
My apologies, Chris. This is
okay. All right, so next we have Chris's conclusion. Chris, just let me know when you're ready to begin. It's 5 minutes, correct?
Yes, 5 minutes. And okay, start my time, Ejaz.
Okay, it started.
Excellent. So remember when I said in my opening statement that there are certain verses that people view, or there's a certain way that people view these verses. And I'm just going to read it again. And it says, this is one view in regarding who Jesus really is. In this view, what people do is they specifically go after the humanity of Jesus and say, see, he can't be God. Now, I would say that anyone who has this view regarding who Jesus really is being very inconsistent and would reject the very nature of their argument being placed upon their Quran. As in to say, if we see in the Quran where there are violent verses, as well as where there are peaceful and kind verses, would it be fair to go after specifically the violent verses and say, see, Islam is a religion of violence? Of course, Akil would say, whoa, Chris, you must use these verses in context and with the whole of the Quran. You cannot isolate verses here and there and come up with your own conclusions, but this is exactly the tactic that Muslims use against the denying the deity of Christ. Also, to keep going, I went on and said in the New Testament, Jesus was born of woman. Amen, he was. But in that very same New Testament, Jesus said, Father, glorify me with the glory I had with you before creation. The New Testament says that Jesus did not know the hour, and amen, he didn't in his humanity. And in the very same New Testament, the apostle says to Jesus, you know all things. Now, in the New Testament, it says that Jesus gets tired and he eats and he sleeps. But in that very same New Testament, the very same Jesus can give your soul rest. Now, I asked Akil two main questions in the cross-examination. The first question was, would you bow your knee and confess Jesus is your Lord? And he said, no, he wouldn't. The reason why he would not is because that would be shirk in his religion. You can only bow and confess that Allah is your Lord in Islam. But yet, Philippians chapter 2, verse 10 and 11 tells us to do that for Jesus. So with him admitting that he would not bow his knee and confess his tongue that Jesus is Lord, he's admitting that the New Testament is teaching that Jesus is God. And that's the reason why he will not bow his knee and confess with his tongue. Because if he actually believed that the New Testament doesn't teach that, he would have no problem doing this. Also, I brought up the passage in Titus chapter 2, verse 3. And it says, waiting for our blessed hope and the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. Akil tried to just push that to the side. Tried to say, well, there's many people that are claimed to be gods and many people that are claimed to be saviors. No, there's not. There's but one, and that's Christ Jesus. Because I qualified what I meant by Savior and Savior for eternal salvation. Not just a savior in a sense of, oh, I'll save these people from Egypt. It is in the sense of eternal salvation. And God is the only one that can give that eternal salvation. And in Titus chapter 2, verse 13, Jesus is identified as that great God and Savior.
Now, I believe I have about a minute left. I just want to go over a few other verses as well, because he was saying something about worship. In Revelation chapter 5, verses 13 and 14, I stated that this is actually taking place in heaven. So when you appeal to somebody on earth receiving worship, that's a red herring to what I'm saying. In heaven, Muslims will only worship God. They would not worship another being in heaven. That to them is shirk. But in Revelation chapter 5, verse 13 and 14, the Father and the Son receive worship from all of creation. This for surely is godly worship. And as I said at the end of my opening, and I will say again and for the ending of my closing. So to conclude my conclusion, I would say the New Testament teaches many things. It teaches we are sinners. It teaches God took on human form, died for our sins, and raised on the third day, which is the good news. And that's the end of my closing statement. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Chris. Okay, give me 1 second. Akil, you are now unmuted. Let me know when I shall begin your time.
Okay, you can begin.
Okay, it's running.
First, in closing, let me just again thank Chris for the discussion. As we mentioned, we know it would be a difficult one, and but that's the purpose of discussion. And I think, you know, Chris knows me, and I know him from our dealings, and nothing's personal here. It's just this is our beliefs, and we're both passionate. So for anybody that's viewing, you know, this is not a personal attack on me or him. This is just us expressing our beliefs in a passionate manner. And this is, it's a good thing. So in closing, when I begin, I ask if we reverse this question a bit and keep that in mind as we go along, then this will help us understand is the question truthful or not. So the topic is, does the Bible teach that Jesus is God? But I asked in the beginning, does the Bible teach that God is Jesus? And if you keep that in mind, then that will help us understand where we're going. In order to truly answer this question, we have to come to some conclusion of who and what is God. And in the Bible, there is various meanings for the word Lord or God used many times. The devil is called God in the Bible. Human beings are called God in the Bible. And they have different meanings. So it's important to understand these things when we look at verses and interpret them. But if we're going to say that Jesus, in fact, the human being, is in fact God the Father, then we've seen from the fact that Chris cannot answer these questions that, you know, the ability for the Bible to justify that Jesus is God is not there. It's not present. We look at the Old Testament. We look at the New Testament. Jesus was born of a woman, and Chris mentioned this. Indeed. But the Bible says that how can anyone born of a woman be clean? This is in Job 25. So when we have passages like this, and when we have things where Jesus is always giving the glory to God and acknowledging God, we have to first and foremost acknowledge that Jesus has distinguished himself from God the Father. Now, the Trinity comes into picture, and that could be another debate, another discussion. But when we look at this question, does the Bible teach that Jesus is God, and we understand God to be God the Father, Yahweh, of the Old Testament, then we believe that, no, it does not teach that Jesus, the human being, is God the Father. And we've seen this from the questioning. Is God and Jesus equal on equal terms? No, they're not. Does Jesus give reverence to God? Yes, he do. Does he acknowledge God as his God? Yes, he do. And we can say that this is all part of the Trinity and we don't understand, but this is the essence of the matter. This is the essence of the matter. We have to understand who God is in order for us to fully answer this question. And when I asked Chris about the idea of God creating and God forgiving, these attributes that's always with God. The Muslims believe that God don't assume or acquire attributes after the fact. God was a creator even before there was nothing created. Why? Because he's eternal. And he's eternal with all of his attributes intact as he was, as he is, as he will be. He don't acquire attributes as he go along. There was one point in history when no one ever prayed to God. And no one ever asked God for anything. So it was God not the hearer of prayers up until someone asked him for a prayer? Was God not a forgiver before there was anybody to ask him for forgiveness? Was he not the merciful one before there was anybody to show mercy? So when you have a dilemma in asking these questions, then that means that there's a conflict or interest in unclarity of who really your figure of God is. In the Old Testament, God is clear. In the Quran, God is clear. In the New Testament, Jesus' figure is not clear. But if we want to go and try to find some clarity, then let's listen to what Jesus himself said about himself. And if we take those statements for face value, Jesus, in many occasions, have denounced the idea of him being equal to God. The Father is greater than I. I can of my own self do nothing. I pray to the Father. So, I mean, these are qualities, and you can say on earth, nonetheless, he's still called God, God in the heavens. And God don't have a God. There's only one God. And if God in heaven, Father is God, and Jesus calling him God, you call Jesus a God, no matter how you want to spin it, no matter how you want to look at it, you are in fact saying there's more than one God. That's the reality of the matter. So given that fact, no, the Bible does not teach that Jesus, peace be upon him, the human being, is God, the Father, the ultimate all creator, Yahweh. No, it does not. Is there any indication that he may be more than a human being according to interpretation? That may be something that, you know, could be acceptable, but is he God? Not at all.
Okay, so I believe that was Akhil's concluding statements. All right, guys, so we have a decision to make now. I'm not sure if the debaters would like to have a Q&A session. They would decide after the conclusion. So that's happened. So I have to ask them, do you guys want to have a short Q&A?
Yeah, I'm okay with that. As long as I can get about 5 minutes before the Q&A, I just need to get out and get a drink and whatever.
No problem.
I've been here for about 2 hours, right?
Okay. What about you, Akhil?
It's fine. What time is it now? Going on 8. Yeah, we can do how long you want to go for, Chris, because
I would only like maybe 3 or 4 questions each. I don't like to do questions and answers after debate normally.
Okay.
It seems that we have quite a few people. There may be some good questions that come out that we can also have some great answers for as well, right? So maybe 3 or 4 questions each. Is that okay with you, Akhil?
That's fine. We can take 3 or 4 each. That's fine.
All right. So could I have about
5 minutes? Yeah, no problem.
Okay.
So 5 minutes.
I'm going to mute my mic and I'll be right back. Okay, guys?
No problem.
Okay.
Okay. All right. So Chris's mic is muted.
I'm going to take a stretch real fast too, Jazz. I'm going to put it down.
No problem.
Okay. Give me my mic and just give me a couple minutes. I'll be right back.
No problem. Bye-bye. Okay, guys. Before you leave, we have 2 forms that we would encourage you to fill out. We have a debate feedback form. You don't got to put any personal information. We're just asking that you give us some feedback about this debate. How were the speakers? How was the timing format? Was the topic structured properly? Did the moderator do a good job? Of course he did, but we still got to ask for quality assurance issues. Was the timing appropriate? All of these things. So you can give us your feedback, please, on the feedback form. And the second form we have is the debate proposal form. So if you're a Christian, Muslim, Jewish, atheist debater, and you would like to debate a Muslim apologist, put your information in. It does not matter who the apologist is. We will reach out to them and get them to come here and debate with you. So please fill out the forms. And if you have a good proposal, we are completely willing to host a debate for free, and we're willing to dedicate time and effort to advertising the debate. So people are asking in the comment section, where do they get to ask their questions? You can ask your questions in the chat, but please do not submit your questions now. When the question and answer period begins, the chat is exclusively to be used only for questions. So you'll post your questions in the chat. The way we'll do this is we'll do 1 Muslim question, 1 Christian question. 1 Muslim question, 1 Christian question. And we'll get to them 4 each. And that's about it. So, we will be taking our audio questions as well. So I see that there are a couple hands up. What would happen is just identify in the chat whether you're Christian or Muslim. And so we can, put 111 So let us know in the chat, and I will give you the mic for a minute to ask your question. We must limit it to 1 minute and one question. Okay, guys? Okay, I have a couple messages with a few questions. Yes, Derek, I do see your message. We have about 2.5 minutes till the debaters return. I think Chris just fell down on his chair. Okay. let me unmute Chris here. Looks like Akil is back. We still have 2 minutes for the break to run. So you guys got 2 minutes. You can relax a bit. So that was a pretty exciting debate. Very interesting comments were made. I personally think that there'll be a lot of reviews and conversation about this debate. Sadly, I don't think Abu Ayyub does not have a question, apparently. Okay, we have about a minute and a half again, so the guys could relax. We have 3 hands up for questions. SM900V, can you let me know if you're Christian or Muslim, please? Okay, SM900V. Okay, looks like the 2 debaters are back. Let me just stop this. I will reset it to 1 minute. Okay, let me unmute both. Let me unmute both mics. Okay, so both mics are unmuted. And we have a Christian, DK. He has a question to ask. So, DK, you have 1 minute to ask your question. Let me just unmute your mic. Just give me a second. And you are unmuted. DK, go right ahead. Hello, DK, are you there? And it looks like he's not there. Okay, yeah, so I'm going
to vote him to the panel. And you may have to unmute him as well.
Let's see. DK, can you speak up, please? Unmute. You're unmuted, DK. Can you hear me? Yeah, I can hear you. I can hear you. Can the speakers hear you?
Yes, I can hear DK.
I heard somebody, yes.
Okay, so okay, you have 1 minute.
Okay, so first of all, thank you, Akio and Chris. I think this was an awesome debate. Obviously, 2 awesome debaters, very passionate. I'm a Christian, so my question is for Akio, who's a Muslim. Your questions and your reasoning throughout this debate often assume what we as Christians would call Unitarianism, or the idea that God is one single individual. So, for example, when you supposedly disprove the divinity or the deity of Christ by saying that he has a father greater than him or God sends God, that would assume that God is only one person and thus God cannot have a hierarchy, or God cannot send God the Father can't send God the Son. So my question is... what if God is not a single self? If God is 3 selves or 2 selves, then God can send God without it being polytheism. Can you comment on that? Thanks.
Okay, so DK, that's your minute. Before Akil answers, both Chris and Akil will get 1 minute to answer the question. Are you okay with that 1 minute each?
Yes, that's fine.
Okay, yep. So Akil, I believe the question was to you. Your time starts now.
Okay, Bismillah. Thanks, DK, for the question. Thanks for the nice words in the beginning. So what we have to first establish is, if you say that God one is 3 persons, you have to bring textual proof for that posture. And I don't think that you can truly bring this proof for the idea that God is triune, especially from the Old Testament and even from the New Testament, and as it relates to anything of clarity. So you may cite verses in the Bible where it indicates God is one, and then you say one means more than one. It's a plurality, like a bunch of grapes or a football team, one team, or we don't believe God is a team. But also what you do is that you cherry pick from the Bible that there are verses that's clearly defining the word ahad, which is one in Arabic, and ichad in Hebrew in the Bible, where it mentions only one and not a plurality or a complex one. So if you're going to bring verses that says complex one means that this applies to God, there's clear verses that show that it does not. And you have to accept the Jewish tradition of understanding that God is absolute one, and their idea of the Trinity is...
Okay, Akhil, that's your time.
Sorry.
Okay, Chris, your minute starts now.
Oh, yeah, I just want to thank DK Man for the kind words as well at the start, and I think that his question is a very legitimate question, and I don't actually think Akhil's actually addressed what the actual question was. DK Man asked that if God was a plurality of persons, is it possible that God could send God? Because Akhil is assuming Unitarianism. So, and I would say that DK Man is absolutely right. If God is a plurality of persons, there would be no problem with God sending God. And that would not be polytheistic. That's my time.
Okay, Chris, that just 40 seconds, no problem. Okay, so we have a dilemma here. We have two Muslim questions next. Is there any Christian in the room? We'll do a Muslim question now. So SM900V, are you going to use the mic? I'll unmute them. Okay, SM900V, are you there? Going once, SM900V, are you there? Okay, we're going to mute that person. Okay, next person in line, Yahya Snow has his hand up. So Yahya Snow, can you speak, Yahya? Hello, Yahya.
Can you hear me, Jess?
Yeah, we can hear you, Yahya. Okay, you have 1 minute to ask your question.
Yeah, okay, thanks for that. I've got to be really quiet, so I hope you guys can hear me. It's quite late, yeah. Mentioning the idea of God being one being and three persons, but where does this idea of three persons come from? Where does the idea of personhood come from? Is there a biblical differentiation between being and personhood? If there is, could you give me the verse, please? Thank you.
Who is that question directed to?
Chris.
Okay, so Chris, your minute starts now.
No, yeah, and for sure, it's definitely a good question. Thank you very much, Yahya. But I would definitely say for that to be an absolute truth, are you saying that it has to be there? I believe that we can deduct from Scripture that God is one. And we can also deduct from Scripture that Jesus is God, the Father is God, and also the Holy Spirit is God, since they're all identified as God. But being monotheistic, they are only one God. But it would be the same as in the Quran, right? A lot of Muslims would say that Tawheed is the oneness of Allah, but there is no word Tawheed in the Quran. So it's kind of a double standard that Muslims like to play on Christians. Go ahead.
Hello, Chris. Is that your final answer?
Yeah. There is a statement, there's one being, God is we are monotheistic, we believe in one God, and in the Bible it states that this God is displayed in three persons, which is the Trinity.
Okay, that's a minute. Akhil, your turn.
Bismillah. First and foremost, Chris accused me of not answering the question, and I mean, what he did there was, I don't even think maybe he heard the question. The idea of God being one and then God being three is something that you have to establish from the Bible. But then Chris turned around after all night saying three people from the Bible, he was asked a question by Yahya, and he said, does it have to be in the Bible? As all of a sudden now, you can answer without using the Bible as your proof. And he asked him about being versus personhood, and is there anything in the Bible that shows that? He brought nothing. And when the Bible talks about God, again, what type of God is it talking about? Because God is used different ways. So, you know, if you're saying that it's used in this way, but it doesn't mean the Father, then okay. The Father is a Father alone. Everything under the Father is other than God. So that's the point. And then he mentioned about Tawheed in the Quran. The topic is not about the Quran. He asked you a question about the Bible. But even the word in the Quran, Ahad, is in the Quran. And Tawheed is the second form, Masdar, that comes from the word Ahada. So because of that, Tawheed is in the Quran. There's not a word even similar to Trinity nowhere in the Bible. Nothing whatsoever, even remotely. But Ahad is in the Quran quite clearly. Qul huwallahu Ahad. So,
Akil, that's your minute.
You don't have your proof.
Okay, Akil, that's your minute. Let me just stop. All right. So, we have to take a Christian question now. I believe Vladimir Susich has a question to ask. Vladimir, your mic is unmuted. You may ask your question. You have 1 minute.
Thank you. Akil, we have dealt before, obviously. We know each other very well. So what I wanted to ask you is this question. I'm going to quote from Isaiah 45. This is actually Yahweh speaking. And I would have to ask you, would you only give this kind of worship to Yahweh? Would you only affirm this of Yahweh? So, or of Allah. So Yahweh says, I have sworn by myself, the word has gone out of my mouth in righteousness and shall not return, that unto me every knee will bow and every tongue shall confess. And of course, it goes on to say my name. So what I have to ask you is, do you consider this to be only applicable to God, that only God's name you should confess and that only to God your knee should bow? Do you consider this to be only something properly done of God?
Would I accept, the question is finished, can I answer now?
Yeah, you can answer.
Would I accept that whatever is belonging to God alone, we give to God alone? Whatever belongs to God alone, we give to God alone. Whatever does not belong, whatever belongs to God, we don't give it to any human being. So you can have terminology or word play that says, okay, where it says it's over here, and then over here it says that, and then you're trying to make it together. We know in the Old Testament, God is who he is, and he's worshiped alone. One, he's God. I would never bow down and give worship to someone that bowed down and gave worship. Because God commands us other than that. God tells us to only worship him. Jesus told the devil, he said, it is written, the first commandment, that thou shalt bow, that thou shalt worship thy Lord God alone. So if Jesus is telling people to worship God, and Jesus is worshiping God, and Jesus is calling upon God, and Jesus is praying and imploring God, why would I go pray to Jesus? Why would I go bow down to Jesus when Jesus is bowing down to someone else? I want to worship God, not worship someone who's worshiping God. Simple.
Okay, that's your minute. Chris, you are next.
Yeah, I just want to thank Vladimir as well for asking what another good question. So Akil says that he will not bow his knee and he will not confess with his tongue because that is only something is due to Allah. It could only be due to God. Philippians chapter 2, verses 10 and 11 says that every knee will bow, every tongue will confess that Jesus is their Lord. So with Akil stating that he would only do this to God, it is now stating that in Philippians chapter 2, verses 10 and 11, it's identifying Jesus as God if people are willing to bow their knee and to confess their tongue. And this is why Akil would not admit that in the cross-examination. That's my response.
Okay, so that's 55 seconds. Let me stop. Okay, so the next question must be from, I believe, a Muslim. Abu Ayyub, are you there? Let me see if I can find you, Abu Ayyub. I'm seeing him. Abu Ayyub, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay, you have 1 minute to ask your question. You may start asking your question now.
Okay, thank you both of the speakers for good debate. My question is to Chris. And basically the core of the conversation or the debate tonight was based on theology from the Muslim side. And so my question would be in relation to progressive revelation in Christianity. Now we as Muslims, we believe that when it comes to laws, there is a progression in revelation and so does Christians as well. But when it comes to theology and God actually revealing himself to people, this is where we have a problem. And I think that that's the core of what Akil was trying to explain in his debate, is that God is, or Yahweh in the Old Testament is describing himself as one way. And then later on in the New Testament, we have something that is quite different that's being explained here. So my question is, where in the Old Testament do you find this concept that Yahweh is revealing himself in a progressive manner? And okay, that's it.
Yeah, 15 seconds. Wrap up quickly.
Yes, and then how then can we then conclude that this progressive revelation of who God is has to stop with the triune God.
Okay, that's your question. Is that towards Chris?
Yes, it's towards
Chris. Okay, so Chris, you have 1 minute. Thank you for your question, Abou.
Well, again, I don't believe that it's progression. I think that this is something that we can view even back in Genesis. Genesis chapter 16, the angel of God, or sorry, the spirit of God that comes down and speaks with Hagar is actually identified as the God who sees me. Hagar actually even said, even wondered how she could live after she's seen God. She believes that she saw God and that she should have died. In also Genesis chapter 18 and 19, we see that God took on human form and come to Abraham. He actually ate, he sat with Abraham. In verse 19, or in chapter 19, verse 24, it says, Yahweh called from Yahweh out of heaven. So it's identifying two distinct Yahwehs in Genesis chapter 19, verse 24. We can also look in Genesis 19 as well, a little further on, it says, Abraham got up in the morning and went to where he stood before Abraham. We also have in Hebrews where God the Father calls God the Son God. So I don't believe that it's a progression.
Okay, your minute. Sorry about that, Chris. Okay, Akil, you have a minute to answer. Your time starts now.
Oh, yeah, bismillah. So the idea of God changing, and this is what we were trying to get at as well. God eternally existed in the same state as he is now, as he will be. God does not evolve. God does not change. God, nothing is added to God as a result of this or that. Nothing is, you know, appended to God. God don't take on something else, another nature. This is all changing the essence of God. And God stated in the Bible clearly that he does not change. So, you know, if you accept this idea of progressive revelation, as it is propounded by many Christians, maybe Chris might not use that terminology, but the thing that happens is that God forever becomes susceptible to change. So when something else happens, you know, it's oppressed, you know, or like that. As humanity goes on, they do wrong to God, and God takes on new attributes and the like. We, as Muslims, we don't believe God changes. And this is what happens from the Old Testament to this New Testament. There's a radical change in the ideology and understanding of who God is. Jews are Unitarian by default. Christians are Trinitarian.
Okay, Akil, that's your time. Okay, so I believe that was a question from a Muslim, that was Abu Ayyub. So we now need to take a question from a Christian. Is there a Christian in the room that needs to ask a question? We'll take one more question after this, because the debaters have to leave. Is there a Christian in the room that would like to ask a question? Chris, would you be okay with taking a question from a Muslim?
Yeah, it doesn't matter to me.
Okay, so it's in the chat. Let me read it out for you really quickly. It says, I'm a Muslim and my question goes to Chris. Does Chris believe that God speaks clearly to mankind in order to guide them? If so, then why didn't the Jews ever learn from God's clear revelation that God is a Trinity? This would mean Chris is more knowledgeable about God than Moses or Abraham, and it means that God was misleading people as to his nature and made people believe for thousands of years a theology that Christians would say we are going to hell if we accept, that is, God is only one. So it's a long question. I hope you guys got that. It is a Muslim asking, so the question goes to Chris firstly, I think.
Yeah, and I believe that the question just has false premises. Of course, we have the incarnation in the New Testament. So to try to say that did Moses know that Jesus was God who took on human form, that to me is just illogical in itself. But if we're to say that Moses did not know the true nature of God, why would Moses have written in Genesis chapter 19, 24, that Yahweh called fire and brimstone upon Sodom and Gomorrah from Yahweh out of heaven? And why would Abraham run out and bow at the feet of somebody that wasn't God? why would Abraham address the person that is in front of him in human form as God if he didn't believe it? Why would Hagar identify the angel of the Lord as Yahweh if she didn't believe it? What people actually have to do is we have to take into consideration what these verses entail. Go ahead.
Okay. Akhil, you have 1 minute started now.
Yeah, Bismillah. So again, this idea of this radical departure from the understanding of the people of the Old Testament to the understanding of the people of the New Testament. When we look at this idea of Trinity, can we justify this idea of Trinity anywhere in the Old Testament? No, we can't. And we can look at verses that may have understandings that may gain some complications to interpreters and stuff like that. But nonetheless, we cannot derive the idea of Trinity from the Old Testament. Not whatsoever. And I would beg, you know what I'm saying, even the New Testament, that there's nothing clear in the New Testament that would give lead to the idea. But also, the Bible is metaphorical, has many uses of words. And we have to define these words and come to an exact meaning of what they mean before we start putting our interpretation on them. Because you can have a word that it may have multiple meanings, and you try to say, okay, here it means that Jesus is God or something, and it just don't apply. So we have to be careful and define the words that we have in the Bible and use in order to come to the conclusion of what is being said. But the Jews are Unitarian. The Christians are Unitarian.
That's your time, Akhil. All right, we have a question from a Christian. It's from Jay. I believe Jay is a friend of Chris, if I'm not mistaken. Jay is asking, Akhil, since you said that God is used in different senses in the New Testament to dismiss the idea that Jesus is God the Father, however, since Jesus is called God in some sense, according to you, then didn't you just agree that the Bible teaches Jesus is God? You have 1 minute to answer, Akhil.
No, and this is what I was trying to say in the beginning, that we have to define what we mean by God first and foremost. When I understand this question that we're debating, we're talking about God the Father, the ultimate God. The Father, the one ultimate being above everything and everyone else. Does the Bible teach that Jesus is this figure? No, it doesn't. Now, are there lesser gods that's used in the Bible? Yeah. I mean, Jesus told the Jews, it is written that, you know, God called you, you know, said you are gods. Jesus, you know, is have this terminology is used for him. The devil is called God. Moses is called Elohim. But when we read the verses that Jesus states exactly who he is versus God, like, for instance, in John 17, it says that they may know you, the true God. Jesus is calling God the true God, meaning that, make no mistake about it, anything other than you is not God. Even though the word may be used, it may be a metaphorical meaning to give someone a higher status. But Jesus called the Father the true God. Anything other than him is not God in truth.
Okay, Chris, you have a minute to answer.
Yeah, and I really think that Akhil is trying to conflate his answer a little bit here, because even in the Quran, in Surah 16 and in the Surah 20, it states, "It is he then who creates like him, who does not create, do you not then mind? And those whom they call on besides Allah have not created anything, while they are themselves are created. Dead are they, not living, and they know not what they not know when they shall be raised." Surah 25, verse 3 says, "And they have taken besides him gods who do not create anything, while they themselves are created, and they control not for themselves any harm or profit, and they control not death nor life nor rising the dead to life." In the New Testament, Jesus is described as a creator. Jesus is the one that gives life. Jesus is the resurrection of the dead. He is the one that rises us from the dead. So from Akhil's very own Quran, it is identifying Jesus as the only true God.
Okay, Chris, you have 10 seconds.
No, that's all I need to say.
Okay. All right. We have a question from Refutin. Refutin, are you here? I need to unmute your mic. We've just taken two last questions. So we'll take in one from Refutin and the last question from Godwin. So let's give me a sec here, Refutin. Unmute. Refutin, you can ask your question. You have 1 minute. Hello, Refutin. Okay, I'll have to mute him. He, okay, he asked it in chat. So the question is towards Chris. 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 17. Now unto the King, eternal, immortal, invisible, the only wise God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. Question, how is Jesus God if this biblical verse states that God is A, immortal, and Jesus died, B, invisible, and Jesus was visible to his disciples, C, wise, and Jesus did not know everything, Mark 13:32. Your question, Chris.
Yeah, again, I will state that God took on human form, and as humanity, he was limited to his knowledge. He did eat, he did sleep, he was visible. But this is something that people just reject, and I don't understand why. In the New Testament, it also identifies Jesus as the one that receives worship. In the New Testament, it identifies Jesus as our great God and Savior. In the New Testament, it tells us that everyone will bow their knee and confess with their tongue that Jesus is Lord. In John chapter 1, it states that Jesus is the creator of all things. These are the attributes of God. Now, if a Muslim wants to say that Jesus is not God, they would have to deny Tawheed al-Asma wa Sifat, because that would be attributing for Allah his most beautiful names and attributes. So if a created being had the attributes of Allah, that would be shirk. It would have to be.
Okay, Akil, your 1 minute starts now.
Bismillah. Chris stated that God took on human form and was limited. This is a problem. You can't say that God is limited. You can't say that God took on a form of nature that made him other than God. You open up too many problems. The language, even if you mean something different, the language. God can't be weak. God can't be ignorant. God can't be other than God. If we allow that, say that God took on a human form, and there's no problem with that, and then God is running for his life, and God is being persecuted, and God is eating and drinking and sleeping and using the bathroom and all kind of things, what kind of God is that? God is being prayed to. God is praying. This is not the quality that we learn about God. It's quite different, and that's a problem. God can't resign. Can God not be God? That's a question. Can God resign? If you say no, then we say God can't do other things either, because it's ungodly.
Okay, God, and that's can't time. Be ungodly. Okay. That is time. Okay. Guys, we have questions coming in still. Do you want to take two more questions, or is that it?
No, I think we just got the one more.
From Chris Godwin. We have all. One from Godwin, and we have another from Amir Hadara. They're sending it to me in chat, so I'm just trying to keep up with it. So Godwin, are you there? Let me unmute your mic. Godwin, hello.
Yeah, I'm here.
Okay, are you Godwin from Hyde Park, by the way?
No, I'm not.
Okay, I heard the British accent. Sorry about that. Okay, Godwin, you have 1 minute to ask your question.
Yeah. So just wanted to ask, obviously, what Muslims usually ask is where I am God, worship me. Actually, I'm just using this in context. I just want to say this quickly. So in the Quran, it says 57:13, whatever is in the heavens and on the earth, let it declare the praises and the glory of Allah, for he is exalted in might, the wise, to him belong the dominions of the heavens and the earth. It is he who gives life and death, and he has power of over all things. He is the first and the last, the evident and the imminent, and he has full knowledge of all things. In the Isaiah 44:6, the Bible agrees. It says, though says the Lord, the King of Israel and his Redeemer, the Lord of hosts, I am the first and I am the last. Beside me, there is no God. And then in Revelation 1:17, 8-18, when it says, when I saw him, I fell at his feet as though dead, but he laid his right hand on me, saying, fear not, I am the first and the last. So my question is, would you say Jesus does he claim to be God in this passage? Or because, actually, I'm using the Quran, but does Jesus claim to be God in this passage? Or you just say this is another false claim from Jesus?
Okay, that's your question. Akil, I believe that's for you. Your minute starts now.
Okay, Bismillah. Again, when we read things about God, it has to be taken different from how we view it if it's said about a human being. Even if creator, if someone has said God is a creator, and then a human being creates, do we mean the same thing? When someone say, oh, he created that software, whatever it is, do we really mean that he's a creator like God? Not at all. But the thing about it is that you use these verses, like Jesus says, I'm the first and the last. If Jesus died, how was he the last? He died. He came to an end. God is the eternal, ever living. God don't die. So you can't take these verses that says this and then try to apply it on Jesus and then forget the fact that you claim things about Jesus that don't fit. We did the whole debate. God is the all-knowing. Jesus said, I don't know the hour. God is the all-powerful. Jesus said, I can have my own self do nothing. These are Jesus' words, and these words from Jesus himself. Why do you call me good? There's only one that is good, that is God. They may know you, the true God. Why do you not answer these verses? He's telling you, I'm not God. But you keep on saying he's God from other verses that's unclear. Verses clear, verses from his own tongue. He's telling you, I'm not God.
Okay, that's your time, Akil. Chris, your time begins now.
Yeah, thank you very much for the question. I think it's a very good question because Akil is actually denying Tawhid al-Asma wa Sifat, which is attributing the most beautiful names and attributes to Allah. One of Allah's beautiful names is he is the first and the last. He's the Alpha and the Omega. If Jesus is claiming to be the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, then we apparently there's attributing one of the beautiful names of Allah to Jesus. And Akil would actually have to say, whoa, whoa, that's shirk. So if it's shirk, it's still teaching that he's God. Also, Akil says that we're going to the ambiguous verses, but I went specifically to Titus chapter 2, verse 13, and it stated that Jesus is our great God and Savior. I also went to Philippians chapter 2, verses 11 or 10 to 11, that every knee will bow, every tongue will confess that Jesus is our Lord. So if Akil cannot bow his knee and confess Jesus is his Lord, he knows that the Bible is teaching that Jesus is God. If he will not state that Jesus is the Alpha and the Omega, as
that's time, Chris.
Okay, go ahead.
That's time. Okay, so this is our final question, guys. I'm sorry, but this has to be the final question. It's a question to Chris.
Are we
it's
doing four questions for me and four for Akil? Because we've had four each so far.
Oh, can you guys take this one last question? It's the final question for the night. Let me see. It's a short question. It's to Chris Close. Why do you say Jesus is God when in John 17:3 he called the Father the one true God, and in Revelation 3:12 he calls the Father my God? You have a minute, Chris?
Well, before you start my time, though, Ijaz, I actually said that we would be able to go for three or four questions, of course. Now, I don't mind this one. But this is just going a little bit beyond on what we actually agreed upon, of course, right?
No problem, Chris. It's up to you guys, like I said, because as I'm speaking, we still have questions coming in. Actually, what we'll do is, I think I'll end it here because people are still sending questions. So I just have one last request. We have a debate tomorrow night with two very special guests. I think you guys might have heard of them. It's Mr. Chris Close and Akil Onkiwa, right? So, guys, what's the debate topic for tomorrow again?
It's, is Muhammad prophesied in the Torah and the Injil?
Okay, and it's at the same time, 6 p.m. Eastern Standard Time?
Yeah, and if I could ask, if we take this last question, but also me and Chris, we agreed that we'll set up a time maybe next week. We're going to try to do a live stream from Radu Shubuhat, where we can open it up for people. They may have some questions that we can kind of, you know, maybe for hours, spend some time covering some of the questions that wasn't answered here. But the last question, you asked the question, if Chris don't mind answering it, I don't mind the question.
Yeah, it's up to you guys, because
that'd be the last one. And
We agreed previously was I would keep asking you guys.
I don't think that one more question would be great or anything. I would rather not do it, but if this person wants to wait until, say, next week when me and Akil are going to do our YouTube live stream and maybe
no
show
problem.
Up your live stream, then I'll be able to answer the question then.
Okay, I'm saving the question here, and I'll send it to you guys privately, okay? Okay, so Akhil and Chris, thank you for coming out tonight. It was a pleasure having you both. I learned quite a lot. I enjoyed the debate. And I'd like to thank the participants for coming out. Chris, have a good night and see you tomorrow. And same to you, brother Akhil. For the rest of the guys in the room, like we said, we have our feedback form. Let us know how Akhil did. Let us know how Chris did. Let us know what you think about the topic that they debated today and what topic they should debate in the future. So here are the forms, guys. I'm going to be closing the room now. So all recordings should be stopped when I press end meeting. So assalamu alaikum and good night, everyone. Thank you for coming.
All right, Kiss. Take care. I'll see you tomorrow, man.
Blessings.
Thanks so much for the night. All right.